Blessed are you, Yehovah our God, King of the universe, who sanctified us with his commandments and commanded us to engross ourselves in the words of the Torah. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, melech ha'olam asher kishanu b'mitzvata v'tzivanu la'asak b'dvarei Torah. So please, Yehovah, make the Torah's words sweet in my mouth and in the mouth of all your people, the house of Israel. May we, your children, all of Israel, know your name and the name of your Messiah, Yeshua. And may we study your Torah simply because it is good. Blessed are you, Yehovah, who gave us the Torah of truth. Amen. You can be seated. We're continuing on in our Bible study with the Ruach and the gifts of the Ruach. It's been a fascinating study so far. We're continuing on. We're only in week number 8, and we haven't even hit the gifts yet. We're just talking about the giver of that gifts and trying to understand who the giver is and what he is all about, so that when we get to the gifts, which I have good news for you, it will be next week. Promise you. I can't promise you, but yes, I think it will be next week. We will start with the gift of wisdom, and we will work our way through. Some of those gifts are, you know, pretty easy to understand, so we'll spend a little bit of time on them. Some are controversial, and we'll spend more time on that, and we'll go back again. We're going to attack, if you want to say it that way, each gift by going back to the Torah, because the gifts of the Spirit did not begin at the day of Acts. They've been around a long time, right? Because in the beginning was the Word. And so the Ruach, which is the demonstrative action of the Father on the throne, has also been around from the very beginning. So we're talking tonight about the gifts of the Ruach, whether they are true, and we know that they are, but they are not new. Because in most of our understanding as we've been growing up, we always thought that on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost fell on the church, and that's a new beginning, and we've come to realize that is not a new beginning, that's just a restoration, remember? Because Yehovah is not necessarily into evolution, but he's into restoration. And evolution means that you change and you have some dispensations, and he can be this way one way, and then he changes a different way. But restoration means we start in the garden, and when he comes and when he puts his foot on the Mount of Olives, we what? We finish in a garden. Amen? And aren't you glad that he is has made you in the image of himself? And therefore, he's trying to restore you back to that image and the power of that image. I really enjoyed what Brother Brent had to say. I really enjoyed when he talked about the Ruach HaKodesh. He did not know that we were talking about the Holy Spirit. And he said that the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, means spirit of holiness. I like that. I burned that in my brain so that I can think about that. Well, we're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. When we look at this, we have to understand the background to those manifestational gifts. We know that 1 Corinthians chapter 12 are talking about manifestational gifts. I put up there the complete Jewish Bible in the King James Version to ask you this question. Is there anything that stands out in those verses or that verse? I gave you two different translations. Is there something you see that's different in one of those? The what? Okay. That's not what I want, but okay. They couldn't speak at all? No. All right, let's look at number one. What's it say at the top? King James Version. Now concerning what? Spiritual gifts. If you have the King James Version, you will realize that that word gift is in italicized, which means it has been added. It is not in the original manuscript. It has been added. So what it really should say is, but brothers, I do not want you to go on being ignorant about the things of the Spirit, which gives you a more broad understanding. It's not just about the gift. It's about the giver of those gifts. And when you understand the giver of the gift, you will understand the gift. So he's not really just focusing on, and we understand this because of who he's talking to, not just about the gifts. He needs them, these people, Jewish and Gentile people, who have come to know the Messiah in the city of Corinth, which we already know has been a focus on Gnosticism, right? The cult of Aphrodite. And we know that there were evil spirits bringing wisdom and knowledge upon people. And so he's making sure they understand, I don't want you to be ignorant about the things of the Spirit. Not a spirit, not one of the spirits, but the Spirit. So the word gifts is not in the text. It's added, yes, for clarity and continuity. And so it might not mess anyone up, but I do want you to understand that some things are added. We see that this is a natural part of translating, especially when we get to verse 4. They put in their gifts because when we get to verse 4, it starts talking about some gifts. Paul, again, is addressing the Gnostic culture in these verses. Remember, we have to know who's he talking to. Why is he talking to them? What is going on in their lives? What is all about this thing? Because when it's 1st and 2nd Corinthians, it's about a group of people, an assembly, a group of people who've come to know the Messiah, and there are things that they're going through. Just like if there was a letter about Lion of Judah, it would be specifically for us. And anyone reading that letter outside could glean something very important from it, but the letter would really mean a lot to us because we know what's going on in here, right? Well, we think we know what's going on in here. So when we look at this, Paul is addressing this Gnostic culture, and he's using that word ignorant, which is agnuo in the Greek, which that word gnosis with a prefix negative participle a, which basically means I don't want you to be with no knowledge. I want you to have knowledge of the Spirit. I want you to have knowledge of the Messiah that you've accepted. I want you to have knowledge of the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. I need you to have knowledge because without that knowledge, you will what? Perish. And you will be torn and blown around by every wind of doctrine. And you will then also mix what you know with what you don't know. And you really need to have some understanding. So this sets up Paul's discussion over the gifts of the Spirit of Yahuwah because he full well knows that the similar kinds of manifestations were taking place in the cult of Aphrodite. I can relate it this way. When you go back to Egypt and Moses with his great big staff throws it down and becomes a snake, right? What do Pharaoh's people do? Same thing. And so these snakes come. The only difference is that God's snake can eat the other ones, right? But what we see here is that there can be some gifts of the Spirit, big S or little s. There can be some gifts of the Spirit or gifts of a spirit that is in operation, which is one of the reasons why he tells us that we have to be careful that we don't follow only signs and wonders because there's a lot of things that can happen with signs and wonders on his side and on the other side. So when we look at this cult or this group of people, the cult of Aphrodite, she is the Olympian goddess of beauty, love, and procreation. She's about fertility. And the main cult center was in the city. It had gone out throughout all the area and region, but the main one was at the Corinth. She is considered the daughter of Zeus. And they would celebrate on the first full moon following the northern spring equinox, roughly the same week what we call in Christian tradition Easter. It was about temple prostitution. It was about sacred sexual rites that were taking place. It was about the logos and the aeons, which at that time were delivering slanderous curses and accusations against the Holy One of Israel. And when I looked up that word logos, and we talked about it last week in aeons, we also know it's about knowledge and natural knowledge and man's intellect. But it also has an understanding that it was a demonic activity like an angel or what we would consider a demon that would dwell among the people and give knowledge. But that knowledge would be more slanderous and would come against the knowledge of God. We have a lot of knowledge today. But a lot of that knowledge is against the knowledge of Yahuwah. So this sets the stage for Paul's message to in this next passage. So he doesn't want them to be ignorant about the Spirit. He wants them to understand what's going on. And then in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3, here's what he says. He says, "Therefore, I want to make it clear to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of Yahuwah ever says Yeshua is cursed, and no one can say Yeshua is Lord except by the Ruach HaKodesh." Now, if you take that at face value, what you're going to say, and this is something that as I grew up in a Pentecostal movement and also have gone to Africa and have participated in deliverance ministries and have seen demonic activity rebuked and cast out, there is a thought pattern that is incorrect. I remember a lot of times in Africa, or even when I was growing up young as a young person, when they were casting out a demon, they would want that person to say Jesus Lord, say Jesus Lord, say Jesus is Lord, because they thought that if he would say Jesus Lord, that means that the demonic power would be released, because the demonic power could never say Jesus Lord. So that's what you would push. You would rebuke, you would cast out, and you would say he's Lord, say he's Lord, say Jesus Lord. And when they would say Jesus Lord, we get all excited because we think, oh man, they're being set free. But this is not what Paul's talking about, okay? Paul is not teaching that only someone who has the Holy Spirit can say Yeshua is master, for this actually conflicts with Matthew chapter 7. That says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. Only those who do my Father, do what my Father in heaven wants. On that day, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, didn't we prophesy in your name? Didn't we expel demons in your name? Didn't we perform many miracles in your name? And if you can continue with the verse, he says what? But I never knew you. So the context here is in contrast to the spirit of the gods, or the logos of Gnosticism. Which means there were evil spirits out there that would imitate the gifts of Yahuwah. And I gave you that example in Egypt. There's people that if there's a healing, you might say, well, only God can heal. And that's true that you might say that God can heal. But guess what? There are evil spirits who imitate the very gifts of the Spirit. But they do not give glory to Yahuwah and will even mock him. They might say in a mocking manner, Yeshua is Lord. But they're not going to give God the glory. All glory is going to go to themselves. It's going to go to that person. And we got to be very careful, because we do have a lot of people who exhibit a lot of what we would consider signs and wonders. And you have to look at them and figure, is the glory going to God, or is the glory going to them? And just because someone can heal someone doesn't mean it's from Yahuwah, because there's a demonic activity that can imitate the gifts of the Spirit. Matthew 7 already told us that. There's many people that will even cast out things and say things and do things, and they never knew me. If we went a little bit further into the Qumran document, there's a document called the Manual of Discipline, and it states this, and we know that it was in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and we know that it states that man receives gifts from two spirits. He either receives gifts from the spirit of Yahuwah or an evil spirit. I bring that up because this is not something new. It's just something true. Paul knew it. The Yeshua knew it. The prophets knew it. The rabbis knew it, right? The writings knew it. There's things that we see that are manifesting that either are from God or from an evil spirit. So this is who Paul is dealing with, and the group of people that he's dealing with. You know, we live in a culture that maybe we're very selfish. So when we're speaking about the Word of God, or maybe if a man like Paul would come, or if I want to deliver a word to you, I would look at what is going on in society and culture and try to deal with that in this house, correct? This entitlement. You know, we have a group of a generation that feels that they're entitled. So, of course, if we're going to talk and write a letter, we're going to talk about the entitlement, the spirit of entitlement that young people have. So we have this understanding that Paul is trying to, before he gets to the spirits, to get them to see the difference between evil spirits and the Spirit. Because all they know is, if there's a healing, it must be God. And isn't that just the way we are sometimes? We'll run here and there because we heard something, and it has to be God, because, wow, isn't God good? And God is good, but there we have to also realize that beyond the signs and wonders, we have to look at the person's life to know them, to see their commitment, to see their integrity. We have to look beyond the flash and the splash of their lives and say, are they living for Yehovah? You know, even it can be a powerful preaching and splashy preaching, this and that and all those things, but what's their life? You can prepare yourself and teach yourself to deliver a good word, but can you walk it? And the thing is, we have to see whether people are walking it, especially in this last day, because we're just so busy following people. If you look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 through 6, and I'm going to use the King James Version, nothing wrong with the complete Jewish, but I'm going to use the King James because I want to use those words that I underline. Now, there are diversities of gifts, but what's Paul say? But the same Spirit. Why is he saying that? Because in 1 Corinthians, it's about a lot of gods. It's about God, Thor as a god. It's about Aphrodite as a god. It's about Zeus as a god. And in that culture, that time, if they wanted to have war and success in war, they wouldn't go to the goddess of Aphrodite. They would go to Zeus the god, because Zeus the god is a god of war and power, or Thor, war and power. If they wanted to have a child or, you know, love, they're not going to go to Zeus. He's a god of war. They're going to go to Aphrodite, because Aphrodite is that's the type of goddess. So in their eyes, in the Corinthian assembly, there were multiple gods, multiple spirits, and you went to whatever god and whatever spirit you wanted. And you see that even in today. So here's what he says. He's starting to teach them, and he says in verse 1, I want you to know and don't want you to be ignorant about the Spirit, right? And he then begins to get them to understand some things, and then he starts to talk about the gifts, and he said, there are diversities of gifts, but the same what? Spirit. There are differences of ministrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. So, multiple diversities, but only one, Yehovah, right? We have him in humanity, flesh, but still just one. We have him in his demonstrative action as a Ruach, but he's still just one. We have wisdom and knowledge and faith and tongues and interpretation of tongues and prophecy and so on and so forth, but we have just one Spirit. The diversities of operations in the Greek, we see energema, and the word worketh in Greek is energio, which, if you can notice, we get the English word what? Energy, okay? So when he's talking about this, this is a direct blow by Paul. He's really going into their thinking culture, and he's getting them to understand that in Gnostic thinking, there are diversities of gods, and therefore, when you're dealing with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, there is only one. He might have different diversities and different operations and different gifts, but it's only still one. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy Yah is one God. So even when you think about this and having different gods, you can kind of see how evolution or dispensationalism started to creep in, because evolution or dispensationalism is really going through one moment and then getting rid of that and starting over with another moment and getting rid of that and getting, you know, and what did we say? We said, is day one good or very good? Good. Is day two good or very good? Is day three good or very good? Four, good or very good? Five, good or very good? Six, good or very good? Six is very good, right? Because you can't have two without one. You can't have three without two and one. You can't have four without three, two, and one. You can't have five without four, three, two, and one. And six means it's completed, and therefore that's why it becomes very good. Is the Torah good or very good? It's only good until you allow it to fill you up, and then it becomes very good. And the reason why when he created the water, it's only good because it can only be very good when he fills it up with all the animals within the water. The air can only be good until he fills it with all the birds and the everything that is in the air. So until it starts to multiply and reproduce, it can only be good. And that Torah that you have, or that Bible that you have on your coffee table, that you have in your, that you carry around in your car, is only good until you allow it to reproduce something in your life, and then it becomes very good. What are you trying to say? I'm thinking that both of them is very good. Because if you find a wife, you find a good thing. And I guess after you marry, you find out whether it became very good or still good. Or whether you would like to, you know, return it. In in this newfound faith of these Gentile converts, remember, they're coming in. This is what they've been under. This is what they believed. We all know. We've been there. We've been not following Torah and then coming into Torah and realizing that there's some things. And it's hard to shift. It's hard to get that some things out of your brain. It's hard to remove some of those old patterns of your life that were there, right? That how you used to do things, how you used to think things. It's hard. Even if you just were in the world and coming in. You got to be careful, because when you come in, you still bring some of the world in here. Right? And it's very, really, really hard. So this newfound faith of these Gentile converts, the Spirit of Elohim is one spirit and produces a diversity of gifts and callings, all coming from the same Spirit, which means variation within the one kind. There is only one Yehovah, one Father, one Spirit, one faith, and only one good tree. And even though there is a wild olive tree, it's still not his. He has to cut you off and engraft you into the one tree. Who is getting saved? Israel or nations? Israel. Now, is Israel part? Can the nations be part of Israel? Yes. But who's he coming for? Israel. Israel entails many, multiple different diversities of people. Right? But there's still only one Israel. And he's coming after Israel. He's coming off after those lost sheep. He's coming after the people, right? Because the new covenant is only for the tribe of Israel. Judah and Israel, and then he later on says Israel. And all of Israel will be saved, which means everyone, wherever you're from, natural Israel, a wild olive tree, somewhere, wherever, come in, you're coming in through Israel, there's only one tree. So there are diversities of manifestations, but the same force. And I want to use that word force because in scientific, you know how scientific I am. That was a joke, people. There is something called unified theory, and it was brought to the forefront by one of my relatives, Albert Einstein. And Albert Einstein was believing that, yes, gravitational pull, electromagnetic force, and there's a couple other forces. Although there are different forces, everything came from one force. And he spent his life trying to figure out what that one force was. And what is this force that they could not explain? If they would have just asked us, if they would have just really opened up the Word of God to really know that the Word of God is true, they would have realized that that force that is holding everything together has been around since the beginning. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. He was with God, right? And we know that everything was created by His Word. And therefore, if everything is created by His Word, then everything has to be held up by His Word. All scientific fields agree that something, or that one something, is what is actually holding all things together. And all they had to do is really read just Colossians chapter 1, verses 16 and 17 that says, because in connection with Him were created all things, right? In heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. And remember, you only need three things to create a universe. And what are they? Space, matter, and energy, and you create something, correct? And what did God do in the beginning? He had space, which was heaven. He had matter, which was earth. And what did he do to have energy? The Ruach hovered over that, and space and matter and energy creates the universe. Visible and invisible, whether thrones or lordships, rulers or authorities, they have all been created through him and for him. And what's the next part say? He existed before what? All things, and he does what? Holds all things together. We talk about him speaking, let there be light, and there was light. And what we have to realize is that the word that he spoke is still out there. You know, all of you know, you type on Facebook, internet, all those things that you ever put on there are out there forever. Scary? Yes. They'll even come back, a memory, and you're like, oh, look at that beautiful memory. But everyone can just, if they wanted to, find out everything about you, because we're so anxious to tell everyone about everything, what we have for breakfast, what we have for lunch, where we were standing at 2 o'clock. I mean, we'll tell everything. And everything is out there in whatever space that is. When Yeshua spoke, let there be light, that word went out, and light continues to maintain. Only until he retracts that will light stop. So by him speaking it, he's actually holding everything into existence, because all he has to do is bring it back, and we'll be in complete and total darkness. So everything is held by him. So again, Paul was trying to get them to see exactly who Yehovah is, who the Spirit is. There are not diversities of spirits, but there's diversities of gifts and operations, but there's only one Spirit, one God, and he has to get them to understand it, because they're really new converts that have been brought up in a very bad situation, and it's really hard to get them to get it going. Now, earlier we established that the Spirit of Yehovah and the Word of Yehovah are one and the same, correct? One and the same. The Word of Yehovah is made up of the 22 letters of the Hebrew language. And the Hebrew language functions just like the universe or even our DNA, which means this. Because all matter and energy come forth from the Word of Yehovah, right? Then everything is going to come forth from that, and therefore it's going to produce a like kind. All right? So this Hebrew language, which functions just like the universe or our DNA, all matter and energy come forth from that Word of Yehovah, and we see that like kind produces like kind. So if he's speaking the Word, then the Word needs to come forth. If he's the Spirit, and the Word and the Spirit are the same, it is exactly what it is. There is a variation within that kind, but he is still the same yesterday, today, and forever. So the diversities and operations of the gifts of the Spirit work like the Hebrew language. And most of you know a little bit about the Hebrew language. Some of us pretend we know more about the Hebrew language. Because you don't know as much as some of us, we fake it until you catch us. But each parent root has a diversity of nuances or meanings, but all come from the one and same root. One or each parent root of most Hebrew words is a three-letter word, okay? And I'm going to explain this to you, three-letter word. For instance, I have four other siblings. And if you've never seen my siblings, and I have one that maybe lives in California, one that lives in North Carolina, one that lives in Missouri or whatever, and you happen to meet them, you might not make a connection that they are part of me, that they look like me or that they act like me. You just think, oh, there's another crazy one that's in California. However, if we all came together and we were standing side by side with our mother and father, what would you see? You would see all the similarities that we have. And you would say, well, yeah, you all look like brothers and sisters. But taking us out, away from ourselves, you wouldn't necessarily know that, right? So this is how the Hebrew language is when it comes to understanding parent root. For example, let's look at this word, and someone tell me what this word means. Kavod. What does kavod mean? Anyone know? Anyone has a computer right now trying to figure that out? Kavod. What does kavod mean? The kaf, the bet, and the dalet. You've used it. All right? Kavod is the basis for glory. Go back to kavod again. Kavod in its natural state or its parent form means weighty, something that is weighty. Okay? Weighty, heavy. All right? Now, when we look at kavod, if you looked at kavod and looked it up, you might find all of these definitions that's coming right now. Glory, weighty, wealthy. See, if you're wealthy, that means you got a lot. Liver. The liver actually is the heaviest organ in your torso. Grievous, because when you're grieving, it's heavy. And gravitational forces, right? Now, they're all from the parent root of kavod. But you need to know what you're saying, because you wouldn't want to say about your liver being glory or have the liver and the glory be the same, because they're coming from the same parent root. So out here, you would think liver, you know what liver is. You would think glory, you understand what glory is. Gravitational force, you understand it. But if you bring it under the parent understanding and you see weighty, then you can understand why all those are connected somehow, because they all have something that has to do with weight. But by itself, you wouldn't, right? So glory, weighty, wealthy, liver, grievous, and gravitational forces, all under the parent root of kavod. When seen individually, you could hardly even guess that those words are all in the same family, but guess what? They are. It is only when you see the parent root to be heavy or to be weighty that it would all begin to come together. It's only until you see all my siblings together with my mother and father would it all make sense that we look alike and that we're part of the same family. Out there on our own, you would not. Okay? He's trying to get them to understand that the Spirit is one Spirit, even though he comes in wisdom, and though he comes over here in tongues, and though he comes over here in prophecy, and though he comes over here in healing, it's actually the same parent root. It's the same Spirit that is giving these diversities. And it might not look like the same, because wisdom looks different than tongues, and tongues looks different than discernment, and discernment looks different than healing, but it's still the one and same. But you cannot substitute the word liver for the words glory, grievous, or gravitational forces. And the same is true for the gifts of the Spirit. Each gift is different, but it's sourced from the same Spirit. It's different, but it's sourced from the same Spirit. Now, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 4 through 6, you might have noticed that twice in these passages, the work of the Spirit of Yehovah is that Greek word energy, energio, or the English word energy is being used. Because the word energy means work. So these are the works of the Ruach. We say the gifts of the Ruach, or these are the works of the Ruach. Remember, Brent said that the Holy Spirit means the Spirit of Holiness. So if you're looking at the fruit of the Spirit, then the fruit of the Spirit should be the work of the Ruach in your life. Which means if the Ruach is in your life, you should have love. If the Ruach is truly in your life, you should have joy. You should have long-suffering. You should have discipline. You should have those things if the Spirit of God is truly in you, because the Spirit of God is working those things in you. And if you don't have them, then the question would be, which energy are you allowing to work in your life? Energy is a biblical term, not a new age type of buzzword that has been used. It is a biblical term. It is one of the things you need to make and sustain a universe according to physics. You need energy. You need the power of the Ruach in your life to sustain you, right? We need the works or the gifts of the Ruach, and we said it last week that means that it's going to stable us, right? Because steady and steadfast, deal with the gifts. That means our hands are being lifted. It means the gifts of the Spirit and the work of the Spirit is for us to maintain us and sustain us as a body, as an assembly, as a kahila, so that we can become like He wants us to become. Because without His energy, we will be whatever we want to be, and we'll do whatever we want to do. This word in biblical Hebrew is dominantly pal-al, and pal-al is the root of the Hebrew verb stems, which means all the verbs actually stem from pal-al. In some form or another, they stem from it. One tree, and everything stems from that tree. One Father, and everything. You can't get to the Father any other way, right? He is the life, the truth. He's the way, correct? The Holy Spirit, or the Spirit of Holiness, is the energy of Yahuwah's work in the universe. We as a body, church, assembly, kahila, kahol, whatever you want to call yourself, without the work of the Spirit, we will only maintain what we can in the natural. And when you try to maintain something in the natural, you become very exhausted. When you try to maintain and sustain your life in the natural, you become exhausted, which is why He said, you shall run and not be weary, you shall walk and not faint. When you wait upon Him, which means when you're having relationship with Him, when you're serving Him, when you're worshiping Him, guess what? The Ruach is having this work in you, and because He's having this energy within you, you'll walk and you'll run. You're not going to be fainting. We get exhausted when we're on our own. We need His wind. We need His breath. We need His energy, right? All of you have looked at a child before and said, well, I wish I had your energy. Well, we need to ask the Holy Spirit, the Ruach, I need your energy. I need your energy, and what I need to do to have that energy is to yield myself to you. And as I yield myself to you and submit myself to you in obedience to you and following your word and following and having relationship with you, then it's promised that the Ruach will be in my life and will lift my hand and steady my hand even when it seems like I'm in a battle or fight, having PGPs and MBOs, having testings and trials and everything in my life. There is a undercurrent of wind that picks my arms up and keeps me going. It's His energy. It's the Father Himself with His demonstrative action that He sends in the form of the Ruach HaKodesh, a wind or a breath that sustains us and keeps us. It's His energy. And we're only sustained by Him, because at any time He withdraws that energy from us, we collapse. The energy of Elohim, so to speak, cannot be separated from Yahuwah Himself. So you cannot have the Ruach, or the Spirit of God, and not have the Father. Which, again, He says things like this. You cannot say you love me and hate your brother. That's impossible. You're lying. Because if you say you hate your brother and yet you love me, that's not going to be possible. Because if you have me, then you're going to have me and be like me. You can't have unforgiveness and be like me. That means you have detached from me. That means the Ruach is not having that energy and flowing through you. Words are energy, which is why the book of Yaakov or James talks about how those words are important and how they can set even hell itself. Your words, as you speak to your children, as you speak to each other, their energy. You got to be careful what you're speaking. And who is here to teach us? Which is why He then sends those gifts, knowledge and wisdom and all those other gifts, so that we can become like Him, so that we can get ourselves under control and become in holiness like He is. So let's look at the manifestation gifts. I mean, not really, we're going to see that next week, but let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7. What's it say? But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man. Is given what? So the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man. That means if three or four of us were around and someone is not feeling well, that means the Spirit of God is not saying, oh, where's the faith healer? You're going to be sick for a while. I can't find him. It means that if the spirit of healing needs to be there, he can come on any man at any time, because the purpose is, if there's someone who's sick, you shall be healed. If there's someone who is confused, you can have wisdom. If someone doesn't know what to do, you can have knowledge. If someone is doesn't know whether it's God or not God, you can have discernment. And whether you're two or three are gathered, he's in the midst. And if he's in the midst, so is his manifestation. But we're not used to that, because we're just used to following people. We want to follow the faith healer. We want to go to the seminar that talks about deliverance. And those all might be well and good, but it's for the profit, the body right here. How many know when you need a healing, you don't have time to get into an ambulance and be taken to the faith healer where you have to wait in line? And then pray that he sees you or calls you, because there's plenty of them that are waiting to be touched. And you're trying, but it's for the body. We are the body. And yes, God is adding to the body, but as he adds to the body, everyone that's here right now, that's supposed to be here right now, is here. Which means all that we need of him, he's more than enough right here. If we had 5,000 people, it'd be better. No, because if you're 5,000 people that don't understand the movement or the manifestation of the Spirit of God, then what good is it? You only need two or three. You only need someone who's going to yield themselves to the manifestation of the Spirit of God. But we're too busy trying to figure it out. I'm going to go before the Lord. I'm going to ask for the gift of healing. Well, it's for the profit. Usually when you're asking for the gift of healing, there's a bypass that you're doing, because you're not really interested in having the gift of healing for people. You want the gift of healing for yourself, because it looks good on a business card. Who are you? Dr. Jeff Myers, prophet. / teacher, / healer, / okay, stop with the slashes. Manifestation used with respect to the gifts of the Ruach. Manifestations used with the gifts, not any manifestation, because he's talking to Corinthian people who have seen many manifestations, right? But what's he saying? The manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit common man, the prophet here. And what was happening in Corinth is that when you're in a cultish and an evil spirit is there, it's really just for you. Not for, again, we have to get used to understanding what the body is for. Could you be with God all by yourself? Yes, but you're missing the purpose of the body. Right? Because what good is an elbow laying around somewhere? It needs a forearm, it needs a hand, you know what I'm saying? It needs something attached to it in order for it to be effective. This word, manifestation, comes from the Greek word paneros, a word that means to bring something to light. To bring something to light. The equivalent word in biblical Hebrew is gala, which means to reveal or to expose. Well, we want to understand why the gifts of the Ruach, which are to have a manifestation, they are then to reveal something, they are to bring something to light, they are to expose something. Well, we're going to go back to the dictionary, which is the Torah, because the Torah explains everything, right? Because that's the foundation, correct? So let's go back to Deuteronomy, and Deuteronomy 29:29. Both in the King James and the Complete Jewish Bible. Let's read it from the King James first. The secret things belong unto the Lord our God, but those things which are revealed belong unto us. So there's a lot of secret things that belong to God, but he wants to reveal it to who? To you as a body, because the manifestation of the Spirit will profit the body. So these are revealed belonging unto us, and to what? Our children. Don't you want your children to have and see the very power of God? So in Egypt, when he was doing all this very powerful thing before the Pesach to bring them out, it was not just that they might know that he is God, tell them that I am that I am, but that their children would know that he is God. Right? One of the reasons why we need to get really pay attention to this Word of God is because it's not just for you. I'm glad that you're making it in, but you have more of an impact that you realize because you're not here just for you to make it in. You're here and have been given children and grandchildren to get them also in. Because look what it says. Why are the secret things that belong to the Lord going to be revealed to you and your children? What's that last part? So that you may do all the words of this law. So why is there a gift of wisdom, a gift of knowledge, a gift of discernment, a gift of tongues, a gift of interpretation of tongues, a gift of prophecy? Why? That you might do this word. That you might follow the Torah. It's not just to give you goosebumps, though it's nice. It's not just to run up and down your spine. Oh, I feel him. But you can feel him, but you need to do what this word of God says. And that's the whole purpose of the manifestation of the Spirit. Remember, he said, I have not come to abolish the law, right? But I have come, to make it short, I have come to do what? I've come to fulfill it. Remember that word, fill? Going back then to Genesis, that when he created the water, it was good, but it wasn't real good or very good until he fills the water. This Torah is good. So what he says is, I've not come to abolish it, but what I've come to do is to bring it back to you and show you how to live it so that you will receive it. And when you receive it and you allow it to fill you up, you are going to see the manifestation of the very secrets that God has hidden from generation to generation that he doesn't want to hide from you nor your children. And you'll be able to do this work, this Torah. Not just the epistles, not just seeing God's son walking in the Gospels, but from Genesis to Revelation, that there might be some mysteries revealed. Didn't he say, I've come to you and I'm speaking to you in parables, and not all of you will understand? Right? So who are the ones that are going to understand? Is God saying, oh, you're my favorite, so I want you to understand, oh, you're my favorite? No. What makes them understand is when they start having ears to hear and eyes to see. When they start opening up their heart, then the very mysteries that are there, the Spirit will reveal through gifts and manifestations called wisdom and knowledge and tongues and interpretation of tongues and prophecies and so on and so forth. So again, it's back to restoring us back to what? To the Word. In our foundation, the Tanakh, we are told that when Yehovah chooses to manifest or reveal something, it is for us and our children, so that we may do all the works of this law mentioned. Train up a child in the way he should go. And when he has what? Whiskers. So that means I'm a child. I just got whiskers this last week. He will not what? Depart. You know why he can't depart? Because the manifestation of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit are lifting their hands and keeping them sturdy and supportive. But when you don't have the wind or the energy of the Ruach, Yehovah's demonstrative action on your behalf, which comes only through relationship, you'll be torn and tossed by every wind of doctrine. And what he was saying to the Corinthian people when he started dealing with his gifts, you're going to have to get yourself in a good relationship with the Father and realize there's not multiple fathers, not multiple spirits. One Father, one Spirit, one way, one Word. Not Gnostic thinking, not man's thinking, not a denominational thinking, not someone else's opinion. It is this Word. And if any of that out there contradicts this Word, you must obey God rather than man. In order for the manifestation of the Spirit of the living God, the Spirit of holiness that brings you back and restores you back to this Word. Deuteronomy 29:29 is about restoration back to the Word, isn't it? So when Elohim's children keep his Torah, they are blessed. Don't you want that blessing that says you'll be blessed going in, blessed going out, blessed in the city, blessed in the country, right? Let's just face it, we're not there yet. We might have a blessing every once in a while in the city or blessing every once in a while, but that talks about a full-blown blessing that no matter where you turn, not even the enemy can come nigh your house. So this is why Paul comments that these gifts are given to us for profit. When we are blessed, we profit. And what do we profit? We profit by having this word in us, and this word causes things to happen in us. So next week when we begin the gifts of wisdom, you have to understand diversities, but yet one spirit, all comes from that parent root. It's him that's giving these things, but it's all for the purpose of bringing us back to follow this word, to be what he wants us to be, the spirit of holiness. So before we begin studying the gifts, we're going to have to be honest with ourselves, because we're going to start it next week. And here's the honesty. The average Bible student's view of the gifts of the Spirit is very similar to the view of the Ten Commandments, which means we have been taught, I have been taught, and have been taught to believe that most of the ten are for today, except for a couple, especially number four. Now, if you've been in my circles, I was brought up Church of the Brethren, so we were very conservative. We believed in the gifts of the Spirit, what we allowed in the church. And there was no one going to stand up and speak a prophecy, because to them, prophecy meant the preaching of the word. Right? No special prophecy, thus saith the Lord. It was the preacher that was prophesying. He was delivering the word. There was not going to be anything called tongues or interpretation of tongues. That was for the book of Acts, and only for the book of Acts, and it's been done away with as soon as they did it. They realized they messed up, and it went right away. As soon as they were labeled drunk, it was gone. Because as conservative people brought up, we were never drunk, nor associated with anything that had to do with drinking. So we could not say, the Holy Ghost will make us drunk. That was no way happening. So, like we picked and chose, chosen which of the Ten Commandments, we pick and choose which one of the gifts of the Spirit would be in operation today. And we do it according to how we feel and how we've been taught and how we've been brought up. Right? Most of us were trained in a religious world. And because we were trained in a religious world, we looked at the Scripture that way. And that way means we like some things over here, but things over there we're not quite sure about, so we pick and choose. We're very excited. It's called drive-through, and we can pick either combo one, if we like it, or combo two. We can even buy a couple combos, but we have the choice of what we put in that combo, which is why we liked it, like when Wendy's, because Wendy's, you can say combo one, but you can choose now fries or chili or side salad. So I can read this word, Ten Commandments, and I can choose one or ten or five. Because if I'm having a hard time with lying or stealing, I'm going to bypass that one for a while. Because he's still working on me. And we pick and choose that way, right? Have you received the baptism? Do you speak in tongues? I don't believe in that tongue. It's of the devil. I was told all the time it was of the devil. You know, I've seen some people speak in tongues. Remember, I said there is an imitation. Because I don't care how many tongues you speak in, if you still as mean as a snake and living like you're in hell itself, I don't know what you're speaking. So we can't judge according to what we hear. We judge according to what we see, and we can judge it because by their fruit you will know them, right? So the traditional church, Messianic congregations, and Hebrew roots people, we all have practiced selective morality and selective obedience for a very long time. Let's just raise our hand and get it over with and say, I've done that. Raise your hand. Let me hear an amen. Amen. The rest of you who raise your hand, you liar. And the truth is not in you. And I invite you to the altar that we can get rid of that demon, that evil spirit that's running rampant within you. Because the manifestation of the Spirit will set you free. Yes, ma'am. As a whole, because we don't study the Word of God for ourselves, so we just listen to the man. And I want you to listen to me because I think I have a good word, but I want you to go home and study what I'm giving to you. Don't take what I'm giving you at face value. Go home and study it. And then if you find that I'm saying something incorrect, go to the altar and pray because you're wrong. And I will try to explain it to you. No. We're learning. People don't want to learn. They just want to be told, and then they're selective of what they want to listen to. It's just our human nature. It's our evil inclination. It's what we are. because, you know, it might make, if there's a preacher that is moved and motivated by the people, and so I know that this couple here has a lot of money, but I also know they're having some, I'm going to skip that one because I don't want to alter and stop my money flow. Do you know what I'm saying? So let's just say I'm not going to be hitting hard adultery when I know something's going on. So I'm just going to tippy toe around that because I still want to be in good graces because at the end of the day, I need a paycheck. Now, that has no effect with me because it's just what it is. But that's what happens. We're motivated by the people. We're wanting to see what the people want, and the Word of God says we're tickling their ears, right? Because we want just to get you enough that you're like amening, but we don't want to get you mad enough that you hit on out. Because we've done a lot to build this up and to come this far. Do you know what I'm saying? But we have to be honest to this word. And if it means starting all over again, it means starting all over again. If it means you offend every single one of the people, because that's what's going to happen this last day. This truth has to be told, and it's going to shake some people's foundations. And the reason why it's going to shake the foundation is because their foundation was shaky already. Yes. Yes. Amen. Amen. Brother? Right. Right. It's been a trap for a very, very long time. And you have few and far people like Elijah or John the Immerser who will pay, you know, with their life or with ridicule because of the truth. You all will know it. You all will feel it. You probably feel it now a little bit, but you'll feel it more because the more that darkness comes and there has to be a distinct, you know, it's very easy to be in the gray areas. It's very easy to ride a fence sometimes, depending on who you're around. Amen. And then I know that's great. There's coming a time when you have to really, the light will have to be. And, you know, when it talks about that separation, it's not talking about separation here against the world. The world's already dark. When he talks about, you know, mother and father, daughter-in-law, you know, and he talks about this conflict. I believe the conflict really is when you start seeing some things and start then living it and speaking it, it's a natural separation. And it's a natural separation even from the religious segment of your life because religious people can be a whole lot meaner and a whole lot crazier than worldly people. Worldly people, frankly, don't care about you. You know, you're like, oh, I'm struggling with the world. The world don't care about you. They don't care what you do. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I'm going to church on Saturday. They don't care if you went to church on Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, as long as you don't tell them to go to church on Saturday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. They don't care. It's those who have this doctrine and are dogmatic about how they believe, and when you try to reveal to them some truth that goes against their thinking processes and what they've been taught, they will rise up against you. They are the ones that are going to betray you. It's the ones that have been walking with you for 3.5 years and dipping the bread in the sup is the one that's going to betray you, not the other ones out there. It's the religious circles that are going to do it, because the truth of the Word of God is going to separate in God's people. Again, the world, they either come to know Him or they don't come to know Him. They could care less what we do, really, honestly, as long as you're not in their house trying to tell them something. And even if you do, they'll just shut the door on you and move on. Here's where the turmoil will be, right? The turmoil was against the religious leaders and Yeshua. And Yeshua respected them and said, listen, unless your righteousness is far greater than the Pharisees, he said, listen to what they have to say. Now, don't follow what they do, but listen to what they say, because what they say is good. So he's not dogging them all the time, right? I mean, and he's very even, you know, you Pharisees, you're vipers, and to his disciples, you're, you know, perverted generation. I mean, so he's fair in his view of, he's fair in, you know, saying this to the Pharisees and saying this to his own people. Right? He's fair, because it's all about just truth. And we just got to get back to just living the truth, which is why now's the time to stop being selective in our morality and selective in our obedience. And if it means altering your life, that's what it has to be. We have to start altering our life to line up with this word and not line up with anything else other than that word. Did you want to say something? Right? And you know, it's we can be just as guilty, you know, in our lives when we just do what we want to do and give God a high five and tell Him, you know, I'm sure you understand. And I'm sure He does understand, which is why another MBO and PGP and trial and testing and a pit's coming your way. Why you have to go around the mountain again, right? He understands. Oh, I get it. But here it comes until you learn it, right? So, you know, my mother and father, if you failed and did something wrong, your mother said, do you have to say, I didn't mean to lie. You know I didn't mean to lie. Oh, I get you didn't mean to lie. Now bend over. I mean, I get it. I understand. I was your age, too, and I lied, too. And guess what? I got the same thing. So bend over. Turnabout's fair play. If I got beat, you will, too. Don't you love me? Oh, I love you to death. And it might be the time you die today if you continue to not bend over, because you must learn, right? You don't just say, "Oh, I get it," so I don't want to discipline you. That would be the most ridiculous thing in the whole entire world. And that's how God is. He says, "Okay," and He's kind of like us. You know, have you ever been told by your parents, "Go into your room. I'll be there in about 5, 10, 15 minutes," because you have to think about some things. God's not always quick. You want Him to do it immediately. If I'm getting in trouble, let me get in trouble. But sometimes He waits. Waits. And again, He's not someone, you know, waiting with a baseball bat. It's about bringing you into holiness, because that's how much He loves you. And He doesn't want to spare the rod, because He doesn't want you to be spoiled. And we've been so spoiled that we've been choosy and selective. And now it's time. It's time we stop being selective. Any other questions? All right, next week, don't forget, of course, Sabbath is coming up, but then we have Pesach Seder, and then next week we're talking about the gift of wisdom. Amen. Let's stand before the Lord. Come on, worship team. Sing us out of here.